Shabbat shalom, everybody.
Shabbat shalom.
Yeah, actually, it still is Shabbat for another 45 minutes or so. So, we're safe. We're going to go over to Jeremiah tonight. And we are going to pick up in the 16th chapter. And we're going to pick up in the 19th verse. Jonathan, why don't you go get me Luke 13 and start at verse 19. But it says here in the 19th verse of Jeremiah, 16th chapter, O Lord, my strength and my fortress, and my refuge in the day of affliction, the Gentiles shall come unto thee from the ends of the earth, and shall say, surely our fathers have inherited lies, vanity, and things wherein there is no profit. Shall a man make gods unto himself, and they are no gods? Therefore, behold, I will this once cause them to know. I will cause them to know mine hand and my might, and they shall know that my name is the Lord. Amen. The Gentiles shall come unto thee from the ends of the earth and shall say, surely our fathers have inherited lies. We're going to talk a little bit tonight about man-made religion. Jesus, and honestly, I think I'm the only person that sees this in Luke. But start there at verse 19, chapter 13, verse 19.
It is like a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and cast into his garden, and it grew, and waxed a great tree, and the fowls of the air lodged in the branches of it.
Okay, that is exactly what I wanted. It is just that one verse. So he says that the kingdom of God is as a mustard seed. Okay, he tells us when he's talking about faith that it's just a little tiny thing, smallest of all seeds. But he talks about it grows up into a bush. But what he's talking about, the birds, when you look at prophecy, the birds are usually bad news. Usually it's an unclean thing that is getting in the midst of it. And the mustard tree, the mustard bush, the mustard plant is representing the kingdom of God. I believe Jesus was trying to tell them already that fowls were going to come in there with false doctrine, and they were going to start mixing things up from the get-go in the kingdom of God. And what do? They make it harder for an individual to be saved. You know, for years, I thought I was the stuff. I really did. I had the doctrine. I had it figured out. I could speak it. I could make it sound pretty decent. I could get my point across. And I found out I had taken one step out of Babylon.
Amen.
You guys, I know you used to climb for a living. You got that lanyard on there. You ever forget and leave yourself hooked up? You're trying to walk away with the lanyard on and it pulls you back? That's what happened with me in Babylon. I thought I had come out from it. I thought I had seen the Trinity and the Trinitarian baptism, and we start walking away from these things. But surely our fathers have inherited lies. You're still in the suburbs. You're barely past the wall of Babylon. Because what they call the Christian church is full of Babylonian paganism. Do you understand how deep it goes in the church? Well, what's it been now? 6, 7, 8 months? I stood up here with that pretty orange rope with all the knots in it, using it as an illustration as I am pulling the knots out. We are taking Babylon out of the church, and sometimes it don't feel good. I'll tell you what, the Sabbath messed with me. I fought it. I didn't want it. It was just a nuisance. But God tells us to call it a blessing. I was just reading in Jeremiah earlier before we came over here. I was reading in Jeremiah, said the Sabbath. We're supposed to take it and make it a holy day. Well, Babylon says no. Babylon says no. We worship the sun around here. You come in on Sunday. That's when you have church. And I'll tell you what, we have come away from the Trinity. We have come away from the Babylonian holidays, but there's a lot of churches out there that are preaching truth that have yet to come away from the Sunday. Come on over to the Sabbath. Get some peace about yourself. Get some rest about yourself. We're still coming out of Babylon. We're still trying to get these false doctrines off of us. We're still trying to come away, and we're trying to see the whole truth of the kingdom of God. And we've come a long way. But I'll tell you what, we're not nearly far enough.
Amen.
We've walked away from Babylon, but it's a long way from Babylon to New Jerusalem. Especially since it's not on the earth yet. It comes down from God out of heaven. Amen. So let's see what happened here. Justin, go get me 2 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. I want verses 3 and 4. Go get me Exodus 32. Go ahead if you've got it.
But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. For if he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if ye receive another spirit, which ye have not received, or another gospel, which ye have not accepted, ye might well bear with him.
Everything we have in the church right now, like there are a lot of people out there, they've got the Godhead down pat. Don't get me wrong. I am not criticizing. We are all on the road. But the thing is, while we're on this road, I don't criticize you for where you are. You don't criticize me for where I am. Because when you're thinking I'm behind you and I'm some kind of person that's not going to make it, I might be a couple steps ahead. You've got to look and you've got to watch and you've got to see and you've got to weigh everything. But these churches that are out there with their Sunday worship, with their sun god worship, with their Christmas, with their Easter, with all these different holidays that come straight out of Babylon, they've created another Jesus. He's okay with sun worship now. Do you know God's okay with Baal worship? Well, I've got some news for these people. If your God's Baal, I'm sure he is fine with Baal worship. But they take these holidays and they put them in the church. And there was a church that we were trying to fellowship with. I don't care if you've got a denominational title over top of your door. I really don't. If you're UPC, ALJC, I don't really care about that kind of stuff. But I drove by, and it was right around Christmas time, and just like us, they're in a storefront church, and I looked through the window. I saw a Christmas tree. Show me that in the Bible. Actually, I can show you that in the Bible. I really can. I can show you that in the Bible. But it's not on the side of God.
Yes, amen.
And the more I research, the more uncomfortable I am with the thought of the Christmas tree being in there. Because it turns, well, never mind. You know what? They've already got a wiener on top of their churches. It's a phallic symbol. That's what the Christmas tree is. And you can take a wild guess what the little balls represent. Take a wild guess. We live in a modern age, and I hope I've still got everybody here with me. But we live in a modern age, and we have modern minds. And you know what? We get the testimony about Justin when he was a baby, how his eyes rolled in the back of his head and everything. So we called on God, we called the pastor, and then we called the ambulance, and they answered in that order, okay? But we live in a modern age where if somebody gets sick, we take them to the doctor. We take them to the hospital. Back then, these pagan cultures had these fertility symbols because they were trying to appease their gods so they could have more children, because half of them would die either in childbirth or they would die before they were 5 years old, because everything about them was contrary to life. So they get down and they pray to their fertility symbols. They pray to their gods. Okay, to us that seems like foolishness. But they brought it along with them. I'll never forget that. Years ago, I guess it's been about 9 or 10 years now. Brother Ronnie was at Brother John's. And that's when I was still driving for Transport America, and I came down and I was in church with him, and Brother Ronnie was standing there, and I made a comment about the phallic symbols. If these people understood what they had on the roof of their churches, he was the only one that laughed, because he's the only one that knew what I was talking about. It's passed into to myth. People don't understand that they're pulling the myths along with them. And that's what they have. They have fertility symbols. We could go deeper into this, which I'm not going to. We could go deeper into this because of the architecture of the basilicas. The architecture of some of these great, big, beautiful churches. It's all fertility symbols. People just don't have an eye for it. They don't know what they're looking at. Would show me that in the Bible. I hope you understand what I'm saying. Show me that in the Bible. They've created another Jesus. And he's hunky-dory with your sin. Their Jesus is. Their Jesus loves the sinner even when he's wallowing in sin. He loves their sin too. They can come on in with it. They've created another gospel. Show me a sinner's prayer in the Word of God. Actually, you can't, because that came about the time of Billy Sunday. Early 1900s, he was a Presbyterian preacher. It was real popular because he was a baseball player, and then he started preaching. And he brought in the sinner's prayer. Get them lined up, get them repenting. Well, you know, repentance is a good thing.
Yes.
But you can't stop at repentance. And there's no way you can learn in one sitting everything you need to repent of. There's a list out there that people don't understand. That they don't understand that they are in error. You guys have heard me mention Billy Cole a lot of times. He was talking about this young couple got the Holy Ghost in his church, and they were high school students. And they came to him one time and they said, well, we were going through the Bible and we found this word, and they looked it up. And he said, well, we're doing it. And he said, well, you better stop doing it, because the word was fornication. But they were never taught that it was wrong. This is not you just walk through the door and start speaking in tongues and you're perfected. Our churches, that's something we have been guilty of, because although you may see people get the Holy Ghost, you may see people get baptized, but there's no discipleship. There's no leading and guiding to the next step. There's no way to bring the children to maturity. You're not perfect overnight.
Amen.
You know, we sang that song before we started the message here. Lord, I'm running, trying to make 199 and a half won't do. But people don't understand that is the message of grace. Do I believe you are going to be absolutely perfect in the flesh? No, I don't believe that. That's not Bible. But I believe you're supposed to continue to take those steps forward. Paul said over in Philippians, I believe it's about the third chapter, that I press toward the mark. That's what we need to do. We are seeking for perfection. Is that going to save you? No. No. This goes back to the whole thing. I have works because I am saved. I have works because He has filled me with the Holy Ghost. I'm not doing this so God will save me. But I want to walk in perfection because He is in my life. I want to walk in perfection because He gave me the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
But these churches that are out there, and they're going to be out there, and they're going to assemble tomorrow, and they're going out there, and they're going to have their Sunday school, and it's not Bible. It's not. The Sabbath was the day that God chose, and this is not where I was going, but this is the day that God chose for us to meet together. Brother Sullivan over in Tennessee, he's been labeling it a holy convocation. That is what the Bible says. Do you know what a convocation is? It's an assembly. We are supposed to assemble on this day to lift Him up and to hear from His Word.
Amen.
But they made their own creations, and here we are 2,000 years down the road. And what do we have? All these creations to us are normal. We're the oddballs because we meet on the day that God said to meet. Amen. And I can show you all through the book of Acts, it never stopped. They always met on the Sabbath. They go into Gentile cities. Gentiles are meeting on the Sabbath. Everybody's meeting on the Sabbath. But Constantine comes along into 300, right in that area, 324, 325, right before the Council of Nicaea. And he says, listen, I want you all to have the day off. Sunday. And it was a holy convocation to his God. But his God is not our God.
Yes. Yes.
His God was the sun god. He was a Mithra worshiper. And I don't see where he ever repented. He might have been baptized a Christian, but you know what? We bathed a cat before. Doesn't like it. But you can baptize a cat. Doesn't make a cat a Christian. I don't care what name you call over it. They brought all this stuff into the church. Surely our fathers have inherited lies. It's lies. If we could just get to the Bible and stay in the Bible, my goodness. I've got so many scriptures to read here in Ezekiel. And I'm flabbergasted when I think about it. Because the whole church, what are we coming into? There's people that profess to be Christians that are excited because Halloween's coming.
Yeah, that's right.
And it doesn't matter that they are trying to put Jesus born on December 25th to them. It doesn't matter that with a Google search you can find out how many Messiahs were born on December 25th, but our Messiah wasn't one of them.
Amen.
Look at the Bible. He was born around the Feast of Tabernacles.
Yes.
They don't care. Well, it doesn't mean that to me, brother. You tell God that when He's sitting on the throne on judgment, you'd say, God, no, I was worshiping you. It's just, I had Him. Doesn't mean that to me. Doesn't mean, well, the Word of God tells us how to assemble. The Word of God tells us when to assemble, and I don't care if it doesn't mean that to you. I honestly, and I don't mean this, I've got people I love dearly that still meet on Sunday, But I'll tell you the honest to goodness truth. I'm having a harder and harder and harder time with it. Every step I take away from Babylon, I wish they would come up, send a telegram, something. Hey, why are you guys meeting on the Sabbath? Because I would be glad to tell them.
Amen.
I would be glad to tell them why we meet on the Sabbath instead of on Sunday.
Amen.
But I'm having more and a more problem with it because I read in the Word of God that God has a problem with it.
Amen.
If God has a problem with it, I've got a problem with it.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Let's go over to Ezekiel. And I gave you Exodus 32, right? We're in Ezekiel, the 8th chapter. And we're going to read about some pagans here. Problem is, the pagans were Jews and they were in Jerusalem, but they were pagans. And he put forth the form of a hand, verse 3, chapter 8, verse 3, and took me by a lock of mine head, and the Spirit lifted me up between the earth and the heaven, and brought me in the visions of God to Jerusalem, to the door of the inner gate that looketh toward the north, where was the seat of the image of jealousy, which provoketh to jealousy. Okay, now why was I talking about the steeple earlier? Why was I talking about the Christmas tree earlier? Why was I talking about the fertility symbols earlier? I have read that some believe that the image of jealousy was a phallic symbol, because it's part of the Baal worship. It's part of the worship of false gods. Okay, so where was it? The inner gate that looketh toward the north, where was the seat of the image of jealousy, which provoketh to jealousy. And behold, the glory of the God of Israel was there, according to the vision that I saw in the plain. Then said he unto me, Son of man, lift up thine eyes now toward the north, the way toward the north. So I lifted up mine eyes in the way toward the north, and behold, northward at the gate of the altar, this image of jealousy at the entry. He said furthermore unto me, Son of man, seest thou what they do? Even the great abominations that the house of Israel committeth here, that I should go afar off from my sanctuary. But turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations. Can you imagine coming into the house of God? And there's that phallic symbol. Well, you don't have to imagine too hard. You put a Christmas tree up in your church? You got a steeple on your roof? Thank God for Brother Boyd. A lot of what I know of these things has come from Brother Boyd. Amen. You can learn more in conversations in passing with that man than any of these preachers out there in the Baptist or the Methodist or the Episcopalian. I just said that because it's fun. But go get me Exodus, the 32nd chapter, Episcopalian, verses 1 through 6. Nobody's staying with me. Now check this out. Go ahead. I'm going to interrupt, but go ahead.
And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mountain, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, Up, make us gods, which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what has become of him. And Aaron said unto them, Break off the golden earrings, which are in the ears of your wives and your sons and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. And all the people break off the golden earrings, which were in their ears, and brought them unto Aaron. And he received them at their hand, and fashioned it with a graving tool, after he had made it a molten calf. And they said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt.
Okay, hold on 1 second. Think about it here. We've got all these false gods here. So they think it was Baal? They think it was Ra? What did they think it was? Go ahead.
And when Aaron saw it,
He built an altar before it.
Uh-huh.
And Aaron made proclamation and said, tomorrow is a feast to the Lord.
To the Lord. Look how it's spelled. Capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. Yehovah. They took the calf. They made a calf of gold with their own hands.
Yep.
Aaron goes out and builds an altar before it. And he says, tomorrow we're going to have a feast to the Lord. They were calling that golden calf Yehovah. Go ahead, finish that out. Yeah, seriously.
And they rose up early on the morrow and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and to drink and rose up to play.
Okay, that's good. Lindsay, can you get me Leviticus chapter 26, verse 1? Michaela, can you go get me Isaiah 29, 13? We're going to read on down here. Verse 7, and he brought me to the door of the court when I looked, and behold, a hole in the wall. Then said he unto me, son of man, dig now in the wall. And when I had digged in the wall, behold, a door. And he said unto me, go in and behold the wicked abominations that they do here. So I went in and saw, and behold, every form of creeping things and abominable beasts and all the idols of the house of Israel portrayed upon the wall round about. And there stood there before them 70 men of the ancients of the house of Israel. And in the midst of them stood Jaazaniah, the son of Shaphan, with every man his censer in his hand, and a thick cloud of incense went up. Okay, he sees 70 elders. Anybody want to take a wild guess how many people was in the Sanhedrin?
70.
Approximately. Give or take. But there was always in that area. These are the elders. These are the leaders. These are the people that are supposed to be leading Israel to God. They are supposed to be the ones that are telling people the right way and the wrong way. And this is what God told us to do. And instead they're in there with their idols and with their graven images. And they are worshiping, burning incense to a false god. Amen. Lindsay, do you have that Leviticus 26, verse 1?
He shall make you no idols nor graven image, neither rear you up a standing image, neither shall you set up any image or stone in your land to bow down unto it, for I am the Lord your God.
Think about that. Think about that for just a second. Could they, like, draw out a plan to get further away from God than what they had been? When you drag in a Christmas tree,
yep.
When you start putting your Christmas decorations on it,
well, brother, it's just pretty. I don't worship it.
Oh, Christmas tree, how lovely are thy branches.
I grew up pagan. I know all about it.
Amen.
Oh, I don't worship it. Then why is your butt sticking up the air when you're reaching up under it getting your gifts?
Amen.
These things are an abomination, but people don't really believe. That's what it amounts to. They do not really believe the word of God. If they did, they wouldn't do this stupid stuff.
Yes.
But they bring it in. They sprinkle a little Jesus on top of it and everything will be okay. Going to hell. Elijah stood up there and he was fighting this very thing. Stood up on Mount Carmel. I know it's the South Caramel. No, that's the northern way of saying it, isn't it? He stood up there, and all these people were gathered around. 450 prophets of Baal and Elijah. And he says, choose this day whom ye will serve. If Baal is God, then by all means, have at it. But if the Lord is God, worship him. And we know who proved himself that day.
Yes, yes.
How far can it get? How far can it go? How far can a church still call itself an assembly of the saints of God? When they're bringing in idols. When they're bringing in the abominations that have followed for years. Do you know Israel never completely forsook God? Israel would go out and they would take the gods of the peoples of the land. And they would bring them in and they would worship them and they'd worship God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why do you think? I mean, they weren't dating God. Why is God telling them, I am a jealous God? Because they were trying to share their attention to a false idol made by the hands of men. To a God who has no idols because he is very real.
Yes. Yes.
People still do it. Easter. There's nobody smart enough anymore to figure out why they dye eggs that came out of the butt of a bunny. Because it was a fertility practice. They would sacrifice the children, they would take the eggs, and they would roll the eggs in the blood of the children. There was only one caller to dye your Easter eggs then. And we bring these practices into the church.
Yes. Yes. Amen. Amen.
And we say God's happy with it. That's we lived back home for a while there, and I had ran into my dad's cousin, and I can mention her name because she's been gone for years, Georgie Smith, sweetest woman. And I remember my stomach about turned because she was selling chocolate Easter eggs for Easter as a fundraiser for the church. Partially it is ignorance. Because people don't know. They don't know. But when you tell them, they get defensive and they get angry at you.
Yes.
For bringing them the truth.
Yes.
Because people don't really want the truth. They want to stay comfortable.
Yes.
In their lies.
Yes. Yes.
Our fathers have inherited lies.
Amen.
There's one truth. There's one truth, and it's in here.
Amen.
And you can go to college for 100 years and never find it. You can read that book to and fro 100 times and never find it. It takes the Spirit of the living God to quicken it in your mind. Doesn't come by education. It comes by revelation. Although I feel like it is a shame that people don't educate themselves. But it comes by revelation. He shows you. He leads you. He guides you.
Amen.
Just like his word tells you. Just like he told the apostles. But you've got to seek him.
Amen.
You've got to seek him. Amen. Then said he unto me, Son of man, verse 12, hast thou seen what the ancients of the house of Israel do in the dark? Every man in the chambers of his imagery. For they say, the Lord seeth us not. The Lord hath forsaken the earth. He said also unto me, turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations that they do. Then he brought me to the door of the gate of the Lord's house, which was toward the north, and behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. Tammuz was the miraculously born,
I like that too,
to Semiramis, who was Nimrod's wife. Shem and his sons killed Nimrod because he was a rebel against God. And she played the harlot, and she had a child, saying that she had received the child from her son, from her father, husband, there we go, that had ascended and became the sun god. So the rays of sun fertilized the egg that became Tammuz. Now the Jews, they got to be right on everything, right? Why is there a month named after Tammuz in the Jewish calendar? God didn't name it that. Tammuz. He lived to be 40 years old. And he was out hunting one day. And when he's out there hunting, he got gored to death by a wild boar. They celebrate his birthday by giving a day for every year that he lived. And they weep for Tammuz for 40 days. Well, the Roman Catholic Church brought this in to Christianity. Another gospel.
Yes.
40 days of Lent.
Yep.
And then you have Easter with your devil eggs. Not deviled, devil. And then you celebrate by eating ham. But they would have you believe that you're celebrating the rise of a Jewish Messiah by eating an unclean animal. Around the time I graduated high school in 1992, there was a song by CNC Music Factory. The title of that song was Things That Make You Go, Hmm. People don't care. People don't care. Leave us and our false gods alone. Leave us and our Messiah alone. Leave us and our false gods and our false ways. We'll call ourselves Christianity. You people that are keeping the Bible, you just go away. You Sabbath keeping, feast keeping, doing what the Word of God says, you get away from us. We don't want you to be called Christian. Because what is out there that is called Christianity is Catholicism.
Amen.
Amen.
Yep.
We're not Catholics. We're protesting.
That protest was over a long time ago. They just brought all that defilement right along with them. Martin Luther, he had a backbone. They could have burned that joker at the stake. But he never went all the way out of Babylon. I don't even think he got to the suburbs.
Isaiah 29, verse 13.
Wherefore the Lord said, for as much as this people draw near me with their mouth, and with their lips to honor me, but have removed their heart far from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men.
Their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men, not the precept of God. Because if it was the precept of God, they wouldn't bring trees into their house. They wouldn't bring trees into their churches. They wouldn't be out having All Hallows Eve. They wouldn't be having this stuff because they would know it was an abomination to God.
Amen.
We don't pray to the dead saints. They can't hear you. They're dead. What good is it going to do you? But you can pray to the living God. and he will prove himself to you.
Amen.
But you've got to come out. Surely our fathers have inherited lies. Don't stay there in the lies. Their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men. Because they have another gospel. They have another Jesus. And I know some people don't like it, and I'm not going around re-baptizing people, but if you just want to be honest about it, his name wasn't Jesus. His name was Yeshua. Yeshua HaMashiach. Yeshua the Messiah.
Amen.
I saw a guy the other day, and I understand God understands our language. I'm not going around rebaptizing people. But somebody had made a comment about Yeshua, and he said, well, as long as you're baptized in Jesus Christ the way the Bible says. I'm baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm not seeking rebaptism. Don't get me wrong. That Bible is a translation. That Bible is a translation from another language that is not English. Another language that doesn't have a J. And I'm wondering if this fella is like in a deficit with his IQ or what it is, or if he just doesn't realize how ridiculous what he said is. We're not going there. Well, I guess I already did, didn't I? Somebody... You're bored over there. Give me Galatians. No, give me Jeremiah. Second chapter. But he said, then he said unto me, hast thou seen this, O son of man? Turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations than these. And he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house, talking about the temple, and behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs toward the temple of the Lord and their faces toward the east, and they worshiped the sun toward the west. Go to the graveyards and look. Which directions is their face planted toward? The east. Well, okay, you guys know, part of my childhood I spent part of my childhood in the United Methodist Church. And I was among the fortunate few that were chosen for the bishop's choir. And we had this Christ the King's Bishop's Festival, I think is what it was called. But we were in there and we had communion, and I just remember it was such a spiritual moment. This guy started singing, let us fall. What is it? Let us break bread together. Let us break bread together on our knees. Let us break bread together on our knees. And that sounds real good. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun.
No.
But you know, the next part of that stanza is great. Oh Lord, have mercy on me. It is so wrapped up in everything that we came out of. I won't say that we believe. It is so wrapped up in everything that we came out of. It's permeated. It's just, it's inside it, and it's nasty, and it's gross. Surely our fathers have inherited lies. And I know I keep repeating myself, but the religious system, and that's what it is, that we came out of, the religious system that we came out of, is full of lies. It is full of paganism.
Amen.
And I know you guys could sit there longer and I could go further, but I'm not going to, but we could just My goodness, the times that the churches that Satan clauses come in and the children get up there on the old pervert's lap. In the church. The Easter Bunny. I love the pictures of the kids and the old Easter bunnies and stuff. Because they're like freaking out because it was so scary looking. That's a little more like it if you ask me. If a rabbit's going to lay eggs, it better be scary looking.
Jackalope.
Jackalope. Hey, we can start a new religion.
Oh my goodness.
Jeremiah 2:13.
For my people have committed two evils.
Two of them.
They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water.
They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and they have carved themselves out cisterns. You guys know what the difference is? Do you know what a cistern is?
Storage water.
It's a storage water, but you go out there and you got this thing in the rock, and Jeremiah, or the Lord is telling Jeremiah to tell him that it's even broken cisterns. But it's just an open pit of water. You know what a polywog is?
An insect?
Baby frog. Tadpole. Tadpole. Tadpoles, mosquitoes, everything else. And in the dry season, if you've got any water in that, that's what you've got to drink. And the Lord is telling them, they have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and have hewn themselves out cisterns. Bugs can't catch up with living water. Pollywogs can't catch up with living water because it's bubbling. It's coming out. It's constantly coming out. Choose. It's coming up to that season again. It's coming up on Christmas, and they say it's the most wonderful time of the year is what the song says, and it's also the most suicidal time of the year. Because all their happiness, people get depressed. You know, that makes perfect sense in this world. Well, if a boy can be a girl and a girl can be a boy, and an 18-year-old can decide that it's not the sex that it was born with, but it can't smoke a cigarette or drink a beer. Makes perfect sense in this world. Yeah. This is the world that they've created, where up is down, down is up. Holy is unholy, unholy is holy.
Good is evil, evil is good.
Hey, it's almost like that's a scripture or something.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Let's go over to Galatians. Jonathan, get me 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. Justin, go get me Matthew 11. I'll give you the scriptures when we get down there. Galatians, the 1st chapter. Paul says, and you know, this is one of the arguments against everything that we do. They want to go to Galatians. And they want to say, oh, you're keeping the Sabbath. Well, that you're trying to put yourself under the law. And they say, well, have you not read Galatians? And I say, have you not read Galatians? They weren't going around telling people, you've got to keep the law of Moses and the Sabbath day, and people go nuts. Because the Sabbath day wasn't part of the law of Moses. They were going around telling men that were 30 and 35 years old that you've got to be circumcised. That was the gospel they was going around preaching. Have you never read Galatians? That's what they were taking around. That's what they were telling people. Had nothing to do with the Sabbath day. Had nothing to do with not worshiping images. The people that had problems with the commandments of God. Which one do you have a problem with? It's only the fourth one. It is. It's only the fourth one. That's the only one they got problems with. Oh yes, one-tenth. They got a problem with one-tenth of God's law. removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again. If any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed.
Amen.
When did the apostles start preaching against the law of God? We've inherited lies.
Amen.
We have people that are trying to cause problems because you're messing with their traditions that they don't understand are traditions because they think it's Bible when it's not Bible. I can show you where we're supposed to meet together on the Sabbath day. I can't show you anything about Sunday. I can't show you anything about the first day of the week being the day that we should assemble. Paul said to have the offering together because it's not the Sabbath, and my dude's coming by and he'll get the offering. That is when the first day of the week is mentioned. And they say, well, no, we hold this as a special day because the Lord was resurrected on this day. Okay, okay. Why didn't the apostles? Why didn't the apostles? What do we got, 15 years or so in between the time that the Holy Ghost was given on the day of Pentecost in the house of Cornelius? Guess what day they were meeting? Well, actually, daily. But their Sabbath day was still holy because that was a commandment given to the body. It was a commandment given to the church. If you understand what the church is. We've got, you guys should have it engraved on your heads by now, but Jeremiah 31 and 31. And the house of Judah.
And the house of Judah.
And the Gentiles. I would say if you're not in that covenant then with the house of Israel and the house of Judah in those days, that you're in trouble. Because the only covenant that it mentions given is that covenant. You better be grafted in. You're a fanatic. Amen.
Amen.
Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. 1 John 5th chapter. And everyone that loveth him that begat, loveth him also that is begotten of him. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and we forget about his commandments.
No.
Well, John was an apostle and we're not supposed to be keeping the commandments, so that's a misprint. Surely our fathers have inherited lies. The lies stay behind me. Choose you this day whom you will serve. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep His commandments. All 10 of them. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous. I see hand gestures. I don't have my glasses on. What are you trying to tell me? Okay, okay. My zipper's still elevated. That worries me. And I can't really see back there. The troublemaker's set in the back, so you don't know what they're saying. Somebody got Matthew 11. 28 through 30, and then we'll go.
Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest.
His commandments are not grievous. His commandments are not grievous. I am resting in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Go ahead.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Amen.
Well, what's he asking us to do? He's asking us to forget about those lies, walk away from those lies, walk away from Babylon, walk away from false doctrine. Embrace the real gospel of Jesus Christ. Acts 2:38 is great. I will never preach anything other than Acts 2:38 when it comes to repentance and baptism in His name and receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. But you know what? We continue on with His yoke. Amen. When you're yoked up, when you take out two oxen and you put a yoke across them, you don't sit down. Put that yoke on there to work. You get moving. We need to learn. We need to move. We need to breathe. We need to forsake the foolishness. And we need to embrace the truth. Amen.